Welcome back to Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular Podcast Series, Interviews with the Expert. I'm your host, Sharon Hayes. I'm a non-invasive cardiologist and vice chair of faculty development and academic advancement for the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine here in Rochester, Minnesota. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Drew Rosenbaum, who's assistant professor of medicine, director of our heart failure clinic, and a transplant cardiologist here at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Dr. Rosenbaum will share with us contemporary approaches to both the inpatient and outpatient diagnosis of myocarditis and highlight the key components of early recognition and accurate diagnosis. He'll give us pearls on the evolving strategies for treating myocarditis, as well as a conceptual framework for which patients may benefit from anti-inflammatory therapies and which may not. So welcome, Drew.
Thanks so much, Sharon, for having me.
So tell us, let's just start with, what is the spectrum of manifestations of myocarditis? What should we be looking for, and what might we be missing?
Sure. Yeah, so myocarditis is a sort of a very broad term, and it implies any sort of inflammation that's occurring in the heart. And that can cause a presentation from anywhere from mild palpitations due to a few extra PACs or PVCs all the way to fulminant myocarditis with cardiogenic shock. And so it's really a huge spectrum of disease. And you often see it in the outpatient setting in someone who's describing something as simple as palpitations, like I said, or someone who has new onset heart failure. In the inpatient side, it can be something as sort of routine as non-coronary artery disease-related myocardial injury pattern, or you could see it as ventricular tachycardia in the hospital.
So that's a pretty broad spectrum. So when should we be thinking about, is this myocarditis and what might early on confirm or make us think that?
Yeah. So in people who come into the emergency department with chest pain, sometimes we can see myocarditis as in that role. And sometimes they'll have elevated biomarkers and a coronary angiogram will be obtained and they'll have a negative coronary angiogram. And that's kind of in the ANOCA category of things. So sometimes that can be a presentation. And what you can identify is inflammation based on cardiac MRI is the most useful modality. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, in the inpatient side, people can come in, as I said, in cardiogenic shock or decompensated heart failure. And if somebody has a new onset decompensated heart failure, and again, you do an ischemic workup and it's not ischemic and you find evidence that there may be myocardial injury, then sometimes, especially in fulminant myocarditis, an endomyocardial biopsy can be obtained that can help achieve the diagnosis because there can be specific findings on endomyocardial biopsy.
You know, I think a not uncommon, you've got a patient, they come to the ED, they get admitted, they might even be taken directly to the cath lab because of a troponin elevation, which we later may see didn't have the usual up and down, right? Or maybe it did. Cardiac MRI has increasingly, but not consistently, been used in those patients. And I think, what is kind of the time frame, and what are should all of them get an MRI, and when do we lose a time frame for diagnosis?
Yeah, it's a good question. It depends on the risk factor. So generally, people with acute myocarditis might not have very many risk factors. They might be young people without the sort of vascular things we think about, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, smoking, etc. And if someone's coming in with acute myocardial injury pattern, or even a chronic myocardial injury pattern, one should suspect myocarditis in that setting. And now, a chest pain scenario might reflect more of the paramyocarditis or myopericarditis, but that's still on the spectrum of myocarditis as well, and is treated differently from other forms of myocarditis. But importantly, if somebody has vascular risk factors, then you might want to think more about small vessel disease or something along those lines causing their acute presentation.
So does cardiac MRI reliably differentiate?
Generally, it can, because people presenting with really significant myocarditis can have a mid-myocardial or epicardial enhancement pattern on MRI, often with elevated T2 values reflective of acute inflammation in the myocardium in the non-subendocardial distribution, which is more typical for ischemic diseases.
So you've talked about MRI. Are there other things other than biomarkers and MRI that we want to make sure we do once we're thinking strongly about, like, how do we start the next step of the workup?
Yeah. So in somebody who's presenting with a more fuller presentation, a biopsy is very helpful. But you want to look for some clues to the diagnosis. So for example, myocarditis can occur in the context of other autoimmune diseases. So if someone has eosinophilic granulomatosis, polyangiitis, as a rare example, or something like a peripheral eosinophilia might trigger you to go down the route of eosinophilic myocarditis workup. Somebody presenting with an acute complaint and on biopsy has lymphocytes within the myocardium, that might be something as simple as acute lymphocytic myocarditis, which is kind of the most common that you'll see in the hospital. And somebody presenting with complete heart block or ventricular tachycardia, especially if they have a history of pulmonary sarcoid, you might think about sarcoid myocarditis. And the workup for that could also include a PET scan. So if someone comes in with you know, a complete heart block who's relatively young, the differential is primarily composed of sarcoid myocarditis and some genetic cardiomyopathy. So assessing the genetic pattern, large gene panel testing for inherited genetic cardiomyopathies, and looking for looking at the PET scan for active inflammation would lead you down a treatment pathway for sarcoid myocarditis potentially.
Once you've made the diagnosis, and we're assuming that you've got the pathologist support and all of the radiology support to get there, right? Where does treatment start? When, where, what?
Yeah, good question. Again, the spectrum of disease within the hospital is variable. So people presenting with chest pain syndrome, myopericarditis, then typically anti-inflammatory therapies used in pericarditis are used. And again, there's not a lot of data supporting all this, but that's what is typically used, colchicine and NSAIDs, as we do in pericarditis. In people presenting with a fulminant form of myocarditis, this treatment is quite a bit different. You want to get corticosteroids on board in the context of fulminant myocarditis, or if you've identified on biopsy that they have either giant cell myocarditis or an eosinophilic myocarditis, because those are very steroid responsive, it's important to get therapy started early to prevent progression of disease and to sort of improve the inflammatory phenotype. So basically, for any form of myocarditis, if you identify it in hospital, treatment can be initiated then. For more rare forms like eosinophilic myocarditis, you want to get the consultative services that are involved in those processes involved. Like if there's a primary hyper eosinophilic syndrome, you might want to get hematology involved. If there is other autoimmune disease, you might want to get the rheumatology team involved to treat the underlying disease.
What kind of doses of steroids are we talking about for these individuals with fulminant myocarditis, lymphocytic, or whatever?
Yeah. In fulminant myocarditis, we typically use up to a gram of solumedrol. Some dose adjusts a little bit, but it's somewhere between 500 milligrams and a gram of solumedrol. We use very heavy immunosuppression for people with giant cell myocarditis, somewhat less for people with, say, sarcoid myocarditis with an acute presentation. We will often start with some methylprednisolone, but use prednisone as the next agent to get, as oral therapy, to get them bridged to the outpatient setting.
I was just going to ask you, would there be any, because theoretically it seems like there might be harm, one in not giving proper treatment, but if you blasted somebody with NSAIDs and colchicine who had an active, you know, autoimmune condition, you know, maybe you also harm their kidneys. How important is having that diagnosis, or do you just throw everything at somebody who's got fulminant myocarditis?
In the fulminant setting, in the, you know, dramatic setting, and someone with cardiogenic shock, you're going to want to throw the kitchen sink at them. You want to start empirically with steroids and get your biopsy as soon as possible. That's really an important thing, assuming you have access to cardiovascular pathologists. And if not, in fulminant myocarditis, meaning people with significant cardiogenic shock and potentially requiring inotropes or mechanical support, you want to get to a place where you have cardiovascular pathology available so that you can make the diagnosis so you can start the treatment appropriately. But in someone presenting with fulminant myocarditis, it's not wrong to empirically treat with high-dose steroids, because although there's some toxicity with that in the longer term, in short term, it's probably better safe to do so than not.
Yeah. So let's say you get them through this tough time. Can you give us just a sense of natural history with treatment? Assuming you've made the right diagnosis, you've got them on appropriate treatment. Are there a percent that don't recover microfunction? Can you give us just some ideas about prognosis for these really sick folks?
Yeah. So on the sicker end of the spectrum, the giant cell myocarditis, we get triple therapy on board. We get the steroids, actually eventually a calcineurin inhibitor and an antimetabolite. And is assuming that people don't need transplantation early, meaning you can get them out of shock and onto good medical therapy and immunosuppression therapy, they can do pretty well. It's that early time frame that matters so much for the prognosis. In sarcoid myocarditis, which is sort of let's say the younger cousin of giant cell, the prognosis is a bit better. So we start with anti-inflammatory therapy. Sometimes we'll add on a steroid sparing agent up front. We tend to do that in our practice here. They can also do very well too if you get on top of the disease and then she got on direct medical therapy if they have a low ejection fraction. Both of those have been demonstrated to be important.
Let's just shift gears. We've talked a lot about the really, really sick patients, but you see people in the outpatient clinic where, you know, they present with heart block as an outpatient, right? That maybe they've got their pacemaker, you're seeing them. You've got a little more time there. What's your approach to, gosh, does this patient have myocarditis?
Right. So with any presentation of low EF, heart block, VT, if there's no extra cardiac manifestations of disease at all, you have to have such a low threshold to get genetic testing because there are so many mimickers of myocarditis among the genetic etiologies, and some of the genetic etiologies cause an inflammatory phenotype, both on advanced imaging and biopsy. So, for example, the ARVC genes overlap significantly with a lot of myocarditis, and so getting genetic testing is critical. In people presenting to our cardiac sarcoid clinic, we often get a whole body PET scan, and the reason for that is to identify to identify if there's disease outside the heart, which is more amenable to biopsy, which gives us a tissue diagnosis and confirms the diagnosis, but also to some extent stages disease. And even if we don't get diagnostic tissue, certainly suggests that this is a systemic process because there are a lot of cardiac isolated processes, the genetic diseases, for example. But if there's inflammatory uptake outside the heart, that's supportive of a sarcoid myocarditis, for example, being the etiology. So we get a PET scan. We have low threshold for genetic testing. We do ambulatory rhythm monitoring as well, which is important. It turns out that PVC burden and non-sustained VT can be kind of a disease activity marker for us in many myocarditis scenarios. So, for example, in the most common form of myocarditis, which is lymphocytic myocarditis, generally that disease process is self-limiting, and we don't treat empirically at all with any anti-inflammatory therapy, unless with a couple of caveats. But you should see those disease activity markers decrease over time with that disease. Whereas in sarcoid and giant cell myocarditis, we use those type of biomarkers to understand whether disease activity is low because we're suppressing it adequately with anti-inflammatory therapies.
What's on the horizon? Research, treatment, or diagnosis? What are some of the things we should be looking to you as an expert over the next year to 5 years?
First of all, the pathologists are working on refining the Dallas criteria, which are the initial criteria that allow them to diagnose officially on endomyocardial biopsy specimens myocarditis. So there's going to be updates on that. And what we really need, just like in many cardiovascular diseases, we need deeper phenotyping. We need to understand what the inflammatory process is, how it's occurring, and then we can translate that into treatment strategies. So there's reasonable. So for example, in cardiac sarcoidosis, there's reasonable models of systemic sarcoidosis in animals. And we know many of the pathways involved. So what we're working on and others in collaboration are more targeted therapies for this disease because corticosteroids are a broad gun that targets everything. And so we're really looking at more targeted therapies for this. And we borrow concepts on that from rheumatologic disease, from transplant actually, and try to provide more targeted therapy so that this adverse effects are minimized for therapy and we get good results. One thing that we don't have an one thing also that we're a little limited on is imaging. So cardiac MRI is fairly nonspecific for what type of myocarditis, even if you think it's myocarditis. And PET scan is also very limited too, because we're looking at radioactive glucose uptake, which is taken up maybe more by inflammatory cells, but can be taken up by normal myocardium. So we really need a targeted radiotracer. And there's work that's been done in our nuclear lab and others to develop novel radiotracers to identify different forms of inflammation within the heart. So that's all things on the horizon. And we're actively investigating some of that here at Mayo too.
Well, that's exciting, because it's on the diagnosis side and on the treatment side, and reducing the burden of illness and burden of treatment if any of these pan out. Anything exactly. else you want to share about this? What is a take-home nugget for us general cardiologists who want to know when to get them to you?
Well, a couple things. One is advanced imaging is becoming almost universal in our world. It's someone presenting with a non-ACS syndrome or, with new onset heart failure or ventricular tachycardia or complete heart block, think about myocarditis as an etiology, get the advanced imaging, but don't let the advanced imaging and the report mislead you. Think broadly about the differential, think about genetic cardiomyopathies, always important. The sicker the patient, the more empiric treatment until you render a diagnosis. The less sick, the more time you have to sort of think about the differential and do the appropriate testing. And then if you're, if you have a disease diagnosis established, there are evolving guidelines, and we're happy to also be involved in the management of these cases, since we see quite a few of them.
Of course. Thank you so much. So this was great. It was great for me. Thank you so much, Dr. Rosenbaum.
Thanks for having me. It was a lot of fun.
This wraps up this week's episode of Interviews with the Expert. And I'd like to thank again, Dr. Rosenbaum, for joining me today and discussing this important topic. We look forward to you joining us again next week for another Interview with the Expert. Be well.